really honored today. We have as our guest, Marca Bristo. Can you tell us why the disability movement started and what some of the things are that we should know about?
Sure. First off, thank you for having me here. It's an honor to be part of ADAPT Productions' historical look at the disability community. In the 1980s, Congress passed a law that created Centers for Independent Living, like Access Living. When we first started, we were one of the first 10 in the nation. Now there are about 500. So back in the 80s, when President Reagan had taken over and started to cut budgets like crazy, the disability community organized through the Centers for Independent Living and began to want to change the paradigm about disability from a medical model where we're looked at as people who are sick and looked at through our deficits rather than through our assets, to a disability rights model. And then in 1986, the National Council on Disability called upon the disability community to speak about our experiences with discrimination. Justin Dart Jr., the late father of the Americans with Disabilities Act, asked people, everyday people, to write their discrimination diaries. Thousands of people sent in stories about the wrongs that had been done to them simply based upon their disability. That all resulted in the drafting of the Americans with Disabilities Act and activism amongst the disability community to get the law passed. So in July of 1990, at a White House celebration, the largest that has ever existed, President Bush signed into law the Americans with Disabilities Act. And I'd like to say that not only was it a legal victory for us, it began to transform our society physically and otherwise, but as Bob Kopka, one of the leaders of ADAPT, said, it was really a victory for our activism. It was the first time that we had truly exercised our collective power, and it lifted up our power in so doing.
Well, thank you very much. And now we're going to move on to Joel Margolis.
What has happened since the Americans with Disability Act was passed?
Sure. Well, I think it's readily apparent as you move around the community to see many of the changes. Curb cuts on corners, sign language interpreters at public events, ATM machines that now talk or provide access for people who are blind. Lifts on buses, not only here in Chicago, but all throughout the United States. Trains that provide accessibility, Greyhound, and most significantly, people with disabilities finally having the right to move out of institutions, costly institutions, to live in homes of their choice.
Independent living.
Independent living. And all of these things would not have happened had it not been for the Americans with Disabilities Act. But there's still so much more to be done. And some of that work has taken the form of subsequent legislation, expanded requirements for the telecommunications industry, for example, requiring that cell phones be usable by people with multiple disabilities.
Speaking of expanded communications, I'd like to ask you, do you feel that the Americans with Disabilities Act, okay, if assertively enforced, gives the disability community all the legislation it needs, or do you feel that there is still more legislation needed to protect and enhance the disabled?
Well, you know, our civil rights are an evolving concept. As issues and individuals face discrimination in areas that we didn't contemplate initially when the ADA was passed. For example, the internet. The internet didn't really exist in any major way when the law was passed. So the question of does the ADA require the internet to be accessible to people who are blind has been an open issue that's been battled through the courts. And As I mentioned, there have been additional types of legislation as the disabilities community's voice has gotten stronger. So I think our civil rights are always a work in progress, and I'm sure we will continue to see new areas that need attention as we go forward. But it's really important that people with disabilities learn what their rights are and exercise those rights. Not all of our rights are embedded in the ADA. Some of them preceded the ADA, such as the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act, the Fair Housing Amendments Act, the Air Carrier Access Act. So it's really important that people with disabilities understand that as disabled people, you are a protected class, and you need to arm yourself with information so that you can properly request and demand that your rights be upheld.
With regard to employment, is access living primarily a legal services tool for the disabled, or is there actual advocacy done by access living in the area of employment?
We're not a job placement site per se, although we do have some programs that assist people, particularly youth with disabilities, in making the transition from high school into the work world or high school into post-secondary education. But we do advocacy around the area of employment and public education. So, for example, we have an organizing group that has focused itself on making sure that subminimum wage is not the law of the land and that people with disabilities are paid a fair wage for the work that they do.
For the benefit of our viewers, could you just give us a brief definition of subminimum wage?
Certainly. There's a provision in the federal IRS law that allows certain categories of workers to be paid below minimum wage. These are typically individuals who work in what are known colloquially as sheltered workshops. These are often segregated work environments where individuals can be paid pennies on the dollar or $2 as opposed to what the prevailing wage is. We believe that people with disabilities should be paid minimum wage like everybody else.
Indeed.
So, and back to your earlier point, it is accurate that Access Living's work revolves around services, advocacy, and legal work, but we take our lead as a consumer-driven organization from the people we work with. And so the thematic areas that most people turn to us for assistance are housing, employment, education, healthcare, long-term care, and some miscellaneous other things, for example, issues around immigration.
We now see approximately 50 years of affirmative action for African Americans and Hispanic people. Do you think that a moral or possibly even a legal argument could be made for affirmative action type programs for the disabled?
Well, in fact, we've always had on the books a federal requirement that people with disabilities are part of the protected class of affirmative action. However, we've never had strong regulations in this area. Under the Obama administration, there were new regulations that apply to federal contractors. And people who do business with the federal government requiring a target of approximately or a target of 7% of the workforce be people with disabilities. And that's across all job classes. So they can't only be looking at people in the mailroom, for example.
That has to be spread across.
That's right. So corporate America is, I think, finally waking up to this incredibly talented workforce that heretofore has been slighted. And these new rules have given some teeth to require businesses to really do a better job of being culturally appropriate, having mechanisms to recruit people with disabilities, making sure that they have reasonable accommodations policies in place, et cetera. And that segues me to one of Access Living's new initiatives, understanding that American business was beginning to work on this and that this is an ongoing issue to tackle the terrible unemployment rate of people with disabilities. Access Living made a decision to start a training and consulting arm that is set up to help businesses become culturally competent in employing people with disabilities. And we're just about to launch it. We're sort of in the preliminary phases, but we'll be set up to provide trainings, consultation, a speakers bureau to help Chicago area businesses really embrace the workforce of people with disabilities.
And all of that is geared towards the idea of finding salaried employment for the disabled.
Yes.
I'm wondering, looking towards a broader horizon, I'm thinking about the idea of self-employment. I have come across more than one or two presently disabled people who became disabled, let's say, in middle age and had long work histories, some of them as entrepreneurs. And I've heard them speak about a great frustration in being unable to launch a business that would be staffed by a cluster of, if not all the disabled, primarily disabled people. However, I've heard several of them say that they have never been able to find any organization or center that has serves as an incubator for self-employment amongst the disabled.
Yep, you're right to point that out. There are, for example, there are gender-based organizations that are working to promote the employment of women with disabilities in the entrepreneurial space. A couple years ago, the state provided a grant to the University of Illinois at Chicago to establish an entrepreneurship program. Honestly, I am not aware of whether the funding for that will continue, but it was an important first step in looking at how do we promote self-employment by people with disabilities. And while we're on this, if you go back to that federal affirmative action rule that I mentioned, one of the things that businesses are now being asked to do is include contractors who have businesses run by people with disabilities. And in the federal, the state, and the local government all have slight, in the county, all have slightly different rules by this, but it is in order to be counted in those statistics that I mentioned earlier, the company has to be certified that they are, in fact, a disabled-owned business. And the city of Chicago, as well as the United States Business Leadership Network, operate certification programs that will verify that people aren't just trying to scam the system and pretend that their sister-in-law is the president of the company because she has a disability when she has no involvement whatsoever. So there are some unique issues related to this.
Now, with regard to the question of employment and legal services, okay, is Access Living there primarily to provide information to the disabled individual as to what their legal rights are in seeking employment and redress for discrimination?
No. If you'd like, I could segue into what our civil rights team does. Currently, we do not work in the area of employment law. I could suggest that your listeners and viewers reach out to Equip for Equality, which does have a employment-related legal component. Our civil rights work right now is focused in two primary areas, or maybe three, fair housing, and there we see complaints on the basis of disability across the board. So it could be rental denial, it could be mortgage denial, inaccessibility of buildings that should be accessible, failure to allow somebody to have an assisting animal. It's a pretty wide spectrum. We also run a testing program where people with and without disabilities are paired and go out to a place where we've heard there might be some discrimination, and we evaluate.
Testing the market for housing?
Well, we're testing to see if there's a difference in the way the landlord treats the disabled person compared to the non-disabled person. And we can use that evidence as long as it's been very carefully collected, and we train people to do that as evidence in court should we need it.
Speaking of court, I'm sorry to
If I could, the other part of our civil rights work is focused on the Americans with Disabilities Act, Titles 2 and 3. Title 2 is a public sector, so we are one of the organizations that brought the big lawsuit against the state of Illinois, three lawsuits, in fact, to uphold a Supreme Court decision called Olmstead, which the state was reluctant to implement, even though the court directed them to put in place a plan to get people who were unnecessarily institutionalized out of institutions. The final area of our work is in Title III, and that it applies to public accommodation, museums, movie theaters, and we mostly look for impact cases where we think by bringing a case, we could have an impact in a broad area. Most recently, the case we might be most noted for is a case against Uber. As you may know, Uber has begun to transform the world of transportation,
definitely,
even though they claim that they are not covered by the Americans with Disabilities Act. They claim they're just an app. We think not. And so we are we've brought this matter forward on behalf of wheelchair users who are unable to transfer in and out of a regular sedan. And we'll wait to see what the court decides. But this is a case that I think has been on the minds of a lot of people with disabilities all over America, because we've had the same problems with the transportation network providers like Uber all around America. They were sued previously for failure to provide appropriate accommodations for people who are blind and reached a national settlement in that case. So, you know, there, and I do know that Uber and some of the other companies have reached out to the deaf community to be a good place to employ people through driving. We're in support of those things. We just want them accessible to all of us.
Including all in the disabled community.
Especially as the taxi industry is being so hard hit. As Uber has come in, the industry is shrinking, and we only just won the right to have accessible taxis. And we don't want to see that disappear and leave us with no other option for private pay transportation.
Now, with regard to housing, I have often heard members of the disability community say that there is simply not enough housing that is specially equipped for the disabled. In seeking to augment the stock of specially adapted housing, is Access Living playing any advocacy role in that area?
Of course.
And what are you doing in that?
Well, first let me say that since the day we opened, the number one service that people with disabilities turn to us for is accessible, affordable housing. And it's all three, accessible, the third one, accessible, affordable, available housing, the three A's. The housing that does exist is often taken by people who need it. For the people we work with who are often on fixed incomes, they not only need affordable housing, they need affordable housing that's subsidized in addition to being affordable. A traditional affordable housing prices out people with disabilities who live on SSI or SSDI. In fact, in all of America, there's no place in the United States where a person on SSI or SSDI can afford market rate. So in many respects, the link between poverty and fixed incomes is a precursor to people having no place to live. Add on top of that the issue of the lack of accessible housing, and it's a pretty significant barrier. That said, We have a long history of advocating for policy reform, for working with the Chicago Housing Authority to allocate greater percentages of their subsidized housing to people with disabilities, working to ensure that IDA, the Illinois Housing Development Agency, which finances a lot of housing, is incentivizing the construction of accessible, affordable housing. We've worked with the City of Chicago, the Mayor's Office, with people with disabilities to make the building code, the fair housing law, and the ADA all harmonize so that when a developer gets his building permit in the City of Chicago, it's also vouching to the fact that if they build to that permit, they are complying with these laws. We also say for people who are looking for accessible, affordable housing, don't give up. You know, you have to go under every rock. And while we can't find that housing for you, we can tell you the best way to go about making sure that you're putting your name in on all the waiting lists. We have a list of those housing complexes that are accepting applications. So it is worthwhile to be in touch with us, but you have to do the work. We can't do it all for you.
The disabled individual has to get out there and
That's
search.
Right. Okay. On the issue of health care, most of our work has been in the area of health care reform, trying to make sure that the health care system serves the needs of people with disabilities. A lot of our early work in the early days of Access Living was to create the state's first home services program. In fact, that was my very first advocacy letter to the governor of Illinois way back when. And we were involved in the very early days of creating the state's home services program. Now, our work is to monitor that program is being run properly, that cuts or changes to policy don't harm people with disabilities, such as the current proposal by the Rauner administration to limit overtime hours of workers, which we think puts disabled people at serious risk. It's very difficult. One of the things we do in direct service is we run a personal assistant training and referral program. So if a person we can help people get connected so they get assessed to be determined if they're eligible to have state-sponsored support for home services. We can help them identify a list of people who could be home service workers for them. And now we have been partnering up with SEIU, who represents these workers, to make sure that the onerous reforms don't fall on the backs of people with disabilities. In healthcare, people with disabilities are the canary in the coal mine. You know, if you make a system that meets our needs, it will meet everybody's needs. And if you make a system that doesn't meet our needs, you will make a system that serves no one's needs, because eventually almost everybody in this country will acquire a disability, and they will need the things that we've been advocating for, especially as the population ages.
And for those who are interested in sharing their stories of medical care with you, or if I may put it this way, accessing the services of Access Living, okay, is the easiest way to contact the organization to call, and if so, they should call the
312-640-2100.
That was 312-640-2100.
That's correct.
Or they may also find you on the internet?
Yes, at www.accessliving.org. And if you would like to be part of our advocacy listserv, which keeps you apprised of all the things that are going on in the world of advocacy, when you call in, ask to be put on our advocacy listserv, and give us your email address, and we're happy to do that.
And I'm sure that many people who have heard you today will indeed call and will be interested in accessing the services of Access Living.
We need to build the army. We need you. Please join us.
And I'm sure that's exactly what you're doing. And I want to thank you for sharing so
much
with us today. This has been richly informative. And I would like to thank all our viewers for joining us once again at Voices of the Disabled, brought to you by Adaptive Chicago Productions. I'm Joel Margolis, your host, hoping that you'll join us again on one of our many occasions when we attempt to serve the information needs of the disability community and those interested in the world of the disabled. Thank you.